Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. This is a video I have been hesitant to make because we're not a language channel. I don't study Chinese or linguistics, but there have been a few events, questions, and comments that made me think maybe this is a good topic to talk about. The other day, Phil and I were watching a Chinese movie on Netflix, and I asked Phil to put on the Chinese subtitle because I couldn't really understand what they were saying. The volume was fine, I knew they were speaking Mandarin, and I wasn't drunk or anything. I simply had no idea what they were saying. Sometimes we have people suggest that we should mark tones when I use Pinyin, otherwise it can be called Pinyin. I also heard people talking about how hard it is to translate or understand the ancient Chinese text because it's so ancient, it's open to different people's interpretation. Once we were talking about Qingcha during Sunday tea book, Qingcha means oolong tea. A friend mentioned that Qing as a word to describe the color, whether it's greenish blue or bluish green, is still controversial. So now here I am, making a video about the Chinese language. But don't worry, I'm not gonna teach you how to speak Chinese. We're still a tea channel. As mentioned, I'm no expert on this topic, but I'd love to share with you what I know. So if anything I said end up being wrong, please don't hesitate to correct me by commenting below. Or if you have something to add, we'd love to hear from you too. We all learn from each other. I would love it if you consider subscribing to our channel and hit the notification bell so that you won't miss any of our future videos. And if you think our content is interesting or helpful, please don't hesitate to let me know by click that thumbs up button. It will really help our channel out. Pinyin is a tool to help people learn Mandarin pronunciation. It's also a standard to spell out names or terms when Chinese characters cannot be used. In ancient times, we used other Chinese characters to facilitate the pronunciation of difficult or obscure characters. Since the early 17th century, spelling Chinese pronunciations with letters has been an endeavor for many. In early times, it was mostly Western priests who wanted to improve communication for their mission. Later on, it was those seeking to help Chinese catch up, and the character-based language was considered part of the problem. Now Mandarin Chinese is the most spoken language, making Mandarin Pinyin the most popular way of spelling Chinese. That's why we mostly use Pinyin on our website, social media, and other platforms. And I totally agree that tones are a big part of Pinyin. When we learn Pinyin in school, if the tones were wrong, then it's wrong. And Pinyin without tones is obviously incomplete, aka wrong. When I started out, I simply followed the most common usages I saw here in the US and Canada. In newspapers, official documents, and whatnot. Pinyin spelling without tones. For example, Beijing, Yunnan. After hearing the suggestions about adding the tones, I thought it through and still decided to not use tone accents with Pinyin. Sorry, but here are my reasons. First of all, Pinyin is a tool for Chinese pronunciation. It's not Chinese. The basic Chinese unit is the character. Characters go together to form words. One pronunciation isn't locked down to one character. For example, cha, it could be tea, it could also be many other different characters. When it's a pronunciation for a whole word, it still isn't locked down to the exact characters, and therefore meanings. For example, cha ye could be like this, which means tea or tea leaf. It could also be like this, which means the whole tea industry, or it could also be like this, a totally different set of characters, meaning night inspection. And all of those share the same identical Pinyin spelling and tones. Though this is not something new or secret, I didn't fully consciously realize this difference between English and Chinese till Phil and I were watching the Chinese fantasy movie and I needed Chinese subtitles to understand it fully. And I guess this is also one of the reasons most of our TV shows include subtitles. I appreciate the suggestion about tones a lot because it made me think, and since then, I have been trying to make sure that when I use this 50% Pinyin, I put the Chinese characters too. Because with the correct Pinyin and tones, you're very likely to end up with the wrong words because they're T terms, less popular, less common, less used. Pinyin input won't suggest it to you at all. But with the Chinese characters, you're set on the right track for Googling and future reading. Another consideration is ease of pronunciation for English speakers. Many people are hesitant to pronounce Chinese T names because they are afraid to pronounce them wrong. With the tones on top of those letters, they will be thinking, what does this mean? Now I'm for sure gonna mess this up. This becomes even more discouraging. I think the purpose of using letters instead of Chinese characters is for easy reading and speaking for those who speak Latin letter-based language. And of course, tones are difficult to type on my Canadian keyboard. I know it's a lame excuse, but it is also a reason for me too. Some of you become interested in Chinese culture and language because of tea. That's so wonderful. So if you are not learning Chinese simply for utility, I strongly suggest you learn Chinese characters. Each one of every character is its own individual, full of story that is fun to learn about. 2,000 years ago, the scholars of Han Dynasty summarized the 6 different ways of how Chinese characters were created. And since then, any new characters have been developed under this guide. Some characters are pictograms, such as Ri, sun, Yue, moon, and Phil's favorite character, Shan, mountain. It literally looks like a mountain or mountain range. Some are ideogrammic compounds. For example, Mu, tree. 2 trees become Lin, a field of trees. 3 trees become Sen, a vast field of trees. Let's stack more trees together. 6 trees, Yan. 8 trees, Sha. What if we put these 2 characters, 5 trees, that's a lot of trees. Sunlin, it means forest. Every character has its meanings. Some could have over 30 different meanings. But when characters put together to form a word, their meanings become clear. For example, the character Qing, it can be used to describe color. So, is it green color or blue color? Well, it depends on the words this character and other character or characters form. For example, 青草, green grass. It means green. 青天, blue sky. It means blue. 靛青, it reverts to the indigo shade. 青衣, black clothes. Now it means black. Same with words. A word could have different meanings depending on the sentence and the context it is in. Though an individual character or word could have multiple meanings, when it's used in context, the meaning becomes clear and unambiguous. Chinese characters also could have multiple pronunciations. 2 to 3 is very common. Some have up to 8 different ways to pronounce it depending on how the character is used. And it doesn't necessarily mean that they have different meanings. Language is also alive. It changes and evolves. Sometimes it adapts. When most people pronounce it wrong, it gradually becomes right. For example, 六宝茶, the character Bao, when used as a place name, should be pronounced as Pu. But it's too obscure now. So 六宝茶 it is. Another similar instance is Liu An Gua Pian, a well-known green tea, the only Chinese green tea that uses exclusively leaves and no buds. Liu is the same character as the number 6, So most people call it 六安瓜片. And certain recent dictionaries follow the trend and mark the place as 六安. However, it had been pronounced 六安 for over 2,000 years, named by Emperor Han Wu Di. And today, locals still think it's 六安 and not 六安. Shu in Shubuar. You will see sometimes people pronounce and spell as Shubuar. While in the dictionary, the character when used alone is pronounced as shou. When used to form a word, is pronounced as shu. For example, to say this peach is ripe, 桃子熟了 in Chinese, here pronounces shou. However, if I say a ripe peach, 熟桃子, in Chinese we say shu. In daily use, people are loose with these pronunciation rules, so it's common you hear both sounds used interchangeably. It's now mostly about speaking habits rather than right or wrong. Interestingly, shu in English pronounces the same as shu in Pinyin. Furthermore, shu has multiple meanings, two of which are cooked and ripe. So is it cooked poor or ripe poor? Strictly speaking, it's neither. Shu in poor means it's a further process, similar to shu tian, raw iron. Ripe poor is metaphorically acceptable, but cooked poor is simply wrong. I know this might make you feel dizzy by now. I just wanted to point out little details about the Chinese language that I just realized recently, and you might not have thought about or noticed. Echoing the point I keep mentioning during our Sunday tea book, language differences are more than words themselves. Language affects the way of thinking, the way of talking, and more. You probably noticed that besides my accent and sloppy grammar, the way I talk is weird too. For example, I like to use metaphors to explain things. This is very Chinese. And based on my observation, not something that is used that often in English. It's a habit of talking in Chinese, in sayings, or explaining things. We like to compare or use metaphors to make a complicated idea simple. However, I often found it works the opposite way when I'm speaking English by using this Chinese way. People might think like, why we're talking about this issue and why are you mentioning something totally irrelevant? I also try to avoid use you too often, unless I really mean you specifically. In the Chinese habit of talking, we often use you to mean people in general. For example, when we talk about cleaning teaware, out of habit, I will say, you should clean up the gaiwan after use so that you won't get it stained. It means, in general, people should do this. But somehow when it's spoken in English, it sounds a bit rude and straight at somebody, you. So I try to replace you with people or we, making it sound less condescending or direct in English. I know little things like this still slip out, especially during a live session when I'm just talking casually. Well, I really appreciate you putting up with me, and I will keep working on it, and the accent, and the grammar too. During the 19th and 20th century, when China was in a miserable situation, many scholars and writers deemed the difficulty of learning Chinese characters as the root reason why China fell behind the West, and proposed discontinuing the use of Chinese characters and only use letters to catch up to the machine age. I'm so glad it didn't end up happening that way. For thousands of years, the lineage of Chinese written language has never been interrupted. It's the base of Chinese culture, with incredible depth and breadth. About 3,500 years ago, we had Jiaguwen, Jingwen, which evolved into Li Shu during the Han Dynasty, an archaic style of Chinese calligraphy, which most of us today could still read easily. During this long history, Many peoples and cultures built their written language based on Chinese characters. Some of them disappeared forever, such as Xixiawen, Qidanwen, Nuzhenwen. Some are still in use and thrive, like Korean and Japanese. So if you've ever considered learning Chinese or are interested in knowing more about Chinese culture because of your love for tea, don't stop at Pinyin. Use it to open the fascinating world of the Chinese language and go beyond it. The purpose of this video is just to share some of my thoughts on this topic. You guys are the inspiration for many, many of our videos. Your participation and enthusiasm on various topics and discussions make our channel a beautiful place. We always welcome different ideas and suggestions so that we can all learn and improve. I hope this video is not too nerdy and it provides you some insights into the Chinese language. If you found this video helpful, please don't hesitate to give me a thumbs up and maybe share this video with your friends who are also interested in this topic. Please consider subscribing to our channel if you haven't already. Hit the notification bell. Until next time, keep steeping!